Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Hopkins Public Health Professor Tom Burke and Jon Samet, the Dean of the University of Colorado's School of Public Health. They recently led a panel on the airborne transmission of COVID-19 at the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine. They discuss all we've learned about how COVID spreads, how mixed messages can be harmful, and how this information can help us make informed decisions about our own risk. Let's listen.
Jon Samet and Tom Burke, thank you so much for joining me.
Glad to be here.
Thank you for having us.
So Dr. Samet, let me start with you. We have, from the very beginning of this pandemic, we have heard about different ways about how this pandemic has been spreading. So tell me, what do we know and how is it spreading?
Okay, so probably to start with, most amazing is how little we knew about the transmission of infections in general. I mean, certainly they've been with us forever, and we have had not enough work, and that those gaps were quickly exposed. So we've gone from not knowing much, certainly know that airborne infections are transmitted through the air by definition, but in terms of big particles, little particles, how long they hang around, how long the virus stays alive, we didn't have much work. And those gaps have been filled, and the workshop that Tom and I were involved in organizing really highlighted just how far we've come.
And so tell me, what do we know now about this disease?
So we know a couple of things. And down at the really basic level, we know that people produce particles of all sizes as we talk, as we exhale. We produce more particles if we sing or speak loudly. And those particles that we produce are sort of simply divided up into the big ones called droplets and the little ones called aerosols. Some importance with the size is that the droplets we spray, I think everybody knows what we mean when we cough or sneeze, and those don't travel so far. The little ones, the aerosols, can stay airborne longer hours. They can move throughout rooms and spaces, and they can stay infectious. So that's really one very important piece of understanding. So it's keeping the infection under control involves not just saying, don't get near people, wear a mask. It also involves how we operate our buildings, how crowded we let spaces be, you know, whether we sing or not in public spaces, have a choir. And one well-documented example of the super spreading event with a choir practice. So we've come a long way in our knowledge.
Dr. Burke?
And we really know that the environment matters. The environment where this spread is happening, whether it's indoor versus outdoor, the temperature really affects the transmission of this virus. And there's a lot we can do, but the environment is important.
So, you know, we were talking about getting close to other people. We know that that is not recommended. And I know that the CDC had defined a close contact as someone who spent at least 15 minutes in a row within 6 feet of a confirmed coronavirus case. But now they've changed that based on new research. And now they're saying that a close contact is someone who was within 6 feet of an infected person for a total of 15 minutes or more in a 24-hour period. That seems different, right? I mean, we wave hello to our neighbors, and are we giving each other the virus that way? Should we be more concerned? Dr. Burke?
Well, I think it's very hard to draw those bright lines and say 6 feet. Well, what about 6.5 feet? And what if that person is really producing a lot of aerosol? And so it's very hard. And I think in public health, we have a lot of respect for prevention. And we really ought to be focusing on prevention as we learn about the spread of this, because it is clear. The airborne spread of this is very important to the control in our success.
Dr. Samet?
One addition I would make, and a topic touched on in the workshop, is just how much virus needs to get into the respiratory tract, into the lung, to cause an infection. And if we knew that, I think we could give a more precise answer to how much time in contact with people who may be infectious. There's probably a range of how infectious people are. Some are probably spewing a lot of virus and some much less. So the idea that it's 15 minutes is enough, or 15 minutes in total, we really don't know. It could be that 30 seconds near a very infectious person is important. So I think, again, the idea of maintaining distancing is critical, and wearing a mask. And the CDC is offering a refinement of the guidance that may be useful.
And there's one thing every student at Hopkins knows, that there are determinants of disease. And so no two people are alike when they're exposed to things. There are host factors. Do people have pre-existing conditions? Do they have immune issues that may make them more susceptible? So to try and have guidance, say 15 minutes, well, for whom? Is that for an elderly person? Really, I think perhaps is way too challenging. And what we really have to know is how to prevent that. And this virus gets around.
So Dr. Samet, my daughter has now gone back to school. She's in middle school. She's wearing a mask. They are distanced in class. The only time they take their masks off is for lunch, and they eat in like plexiglass partitions, basically. How safe is that?
Great question. And of course, safety means we actually know the risk of what she's up to. You know, it sounds like all reasonable measures are being taken. I've not heard about little plexiglass booths for eating, but it does, I suppose, make sense. I mean, I think that sounds like the school is doing all it can do. I think one notion we can probably set aside is that middle school children are either invulnerable, they're not, or that they are not spreaders, they can. So I think, you know, it's pretty clear that while young children under 10, say, may not be an important source of household contacts, middle school children are. So it's not only safety for her, it's safety for everyone in contact with her, and clearly everybody in your home.
It's interesting, too, because the more we learn about how it spreads, the more we kind of might doubt that some of these measures are even doing anything, right?
And that's the importance of this aerosol versus droplets, because the aerosols are not at 6 feet saying, okay, time for me to drop to the floor. They're keeping on going, and they may go on all the way across the room. Maybe that's 100 feet and stay there. So I think that's really the importance of the topic that the workshop at the National Academies addressed, was, are these small particles an important source of infection? And that answer came back clearly, yes.
But it was a long time before we really understood that, wasn't it? I mean, we've gotten some mixed messages along the way. Isn't that right, Dr. Burke?
We have. And unfortunately, there's been political hay made from those mixed messages. For instance, the early messages about masks, which were really probably more due to the limited supply chain and protecting our most vulnerable than they were to understanding airborne transmission. And now we know. And science moves along, and prevention moves along, and we've got to move along with that science and listen to it.
So I also understand you guys had some interesting findings about spreaders and gender. And I don't know, Dr. Burke, if you wanted to address that.
Well, I think one of the most interesting discussions was about the gender differences. And you know, my wife would probably say that she knew this all along, but it turns out that men spew a little bit more in terms of both droplets and aerosols. We're not that we're loud mouse, but speaking softly is a virtue when it comes to preventing the spread. And in terms of risky behavior is a big part of this. And men are more likely to engage in risky behavior. They are less likely to wear a mask. And so as we address the behavioral aspects of this and consider the gender aspects of this, we've got to realize that. But once again, I think women have shown us that they're better at certain things, public health, and men take risks.
Dr. Samet, what concerns do you have sort of in the moment about what we understand to be risky, what we don't understand to be risky?
Well, I think we are, first off, we're learning learning more, but clearly large crowds, places where people talk loudly, maybe too close to one another are risky. And I a great example, I mean, here in Colorado, the governor limited bar hours because we showed the governor data on people hanging out in places that where alcohol served from 10 to 2 a.m., probably close to one another, probably not being adherent to all social distancing measures. So I think we need to identify those circumstances that convey risk. I mean, you know, another and very controversial but understandable place for risk is houses of worship, where people may not be adequately spaced. We certainly know that singing, talking loudly, chanting releases a lot of particles. So there are these events, super spreading events, that we need to be very careful to limit. I think just to echo what my colleague Tom Burke said, and we know a lot, we just need to put it into practice and have people be adherent. I think what is a big problem now for all of us in public health and for the population in general is the fact that we're now heading into what, roughly month eight, with months to come. And I think remaining adherent to what we need to do is going to be one of our biggest public health challenges.
There's a lot of fatigue, I mean, right, Dr. Burke? I mean,
fatigue. I would love to go to a football game and drink beer and shout with all my friends, or even just stand in a bar and watch a game. Jon Samet and I happen to be accomplished basketball players and fans, and it was strange watching empty arenas as we were watching the finals of the NBA, right? So we are tired of this, but we have to understand the nature of this virus, and these are sacrifices that are going to let us get through this and reopen.
It's frustrating for someone like me, and I assume for someone, for folks like you. I mean, I know a little too much about this, right? And I'm a rule follower, and I see people around me who aren't, and it makes me wonder if all of my sacrifices will end up being in vain.
Well, it has to be a collective. I mean, that's certainly true. And you know, with the politicization of the epidemic, it's really become a problem that, you know, we have some group in the population who are adherent and doing their best. And then we have people who I wouldn't say are flaunting the rules. They're saying they don't believe what should be done. They, some even would state that the whole idea of a pandemic is a fraud. And of course, that's not true. But if there are those people who believe that and believe that the preventative measures are not necessary, they pose a risk to everyone else.
And Dr. Burke, we've talked about this before, science, right? I mean, so the science continues to evolve on this, and we sort of don't know what we're going to learn about this next week.
But we do know so many things that we can talk about now that really, as Dr. Redfield at CDC said, may be even more effective than a vaccine. And those are measures as basic as masks, ventilation, good sanitation, and distancing, and when you can, being in the great outdoors. And that would be a tremendous reduction in risk if we could get good compliance with that and people would understand that the sacrifices are worth it.
Thank you both so much for joining me today.
Yeah, pleased to be here.
Thanks for having us.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmon, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.